I mean, the sample.
Failure. All right, this is On Hold with Atchka. I'm your host, Shannon, and today we've got a real ass kicker. You think it's more of an ass kicker or a barn burner?
I prefer ass kicker.
Okay. All right. Today we have an ass kicker of an interview with Michael Karolchyk, creator of Michael Karolchyk's Anti-Gym Revolution and Frequent Asshole. We spoke on a number of subjects. We started out talking about, I think let's just delve into it. I think you don't want me to talk anymore. So here it is. Atchka and Michael Karolchyk. Okay, I'm speaking with Michael Karolchyk, the founder of the Anti-Gym, based in Denver, and now you're also in Los Angeles, correct?
We're in Santa Monica and San Diego.
Okay. Now, there have been a lot of people who have joined in the war on obesity, and you've obviously become one of the very visual people in that fight. I'm just curious, what motivates you in the fight against obesity?
Well, a couple things. The first thing, most importantly, is changing people's lives in terms of their health and their sexuality. And the second thing is preventing a bigger disaster, no pun intended, for our country in the future. The first one is the big one, is health, obesity, is one of the leading causes of high blood pressure, one of the leading causes of hypertension, one of the leading problems of heart disease. There's so many issues it's affecting. It's 11% of our health bill each year. It went from 6% in 1998 total cost to 11%. Estimates are almost $150 billion a year. So you can't even address the health issue in this country about looking at obesity. The second thing is sexuality. The number one reason the divorce rate is so high in the United States is it's directly linked to obesity. If you look at other countries where obesity is high, it's almost the exact rate of the divorce rate. So for anybody that's worked in our field, they know that one of the biggest things women come and see somebody to lose weight or change their body is because they no longer want to be intimate. They no longer want to be in a bathing suit because of the way they look. So that's where the health and sexuality is the first part. The second part is, again, what's going to be the future of the United States. If we keep debating Obama every single night's health plan, and it's now 11%, and projections are 20% of the health cost of our country will be obesity, look no further than our elementary schools and middle schools. In this weak pussification of America, we now have everybody making excuses and being victims, and the obesity continues growing, which is what we believe is the number one reason there is obesity, again, that people feel they're victims.
Now, you say you're worried about the future of the U.S. Like, are you worried about, what, the obesity rates continuing to rise?
Oh, it's going to continue to rise, even though the latest lot of large groups, plus-size groups, point to the Economist, where they had an article recently where obesity has leveled off. Well, of course, it's not gone up as much because it's so high now. We're in the mid-30s. It will continue to rise, especially since we're seeing such the high levels in child obesity. And already there is action for airlines and other industries to treat obese people as handicapped, having a condition. Now, what does that mean? That means down the road we're going to see bigger airline seats, which will mean higher airline prices. We're already seeing higher fuel costs because of the obesity in the United States.
Well, now you mentioned airline seats, and they've been reducing them with reducing prices, and that's kind of caused a crunch all across, not only with aspect of weight, but also height. Taller people are having trouble with people putting their seats back and asking the people in front of them not to put it back, and that's, you know, That's a height problem.
They should be able to do what they want to do with their own seats. But what's happening right now?
No, they're talking about the person in front of them. The
no,
adult...
I,
So
go ahead, I'm sorry.
Should the person in front of them be able to put their seat back even though there's not enough leg room for the person behind them?
I think the tall person has to buy two seats as well. I've always advocated that. It's all about space.
But two seats doesn't really solve leg room. I mean, the seats are side by side.
Well, actually, if you could buy a seat in front of you and a seat behind you, and then you solve the problem with the tall person. And that's what actually some NBA players do currently. And getting back to what I'm saying is if you look at where it's going, in Massachusetts and other states are trying to make obesity a medical condition. Why? The trial lawyers are trying to make obesity a condition so they can sue class action suits with airline industries and everything else, making sure that they're handicap accessible. I don't think being fat and large is a handicap. I think it's a condition of being lazy, as it do the majority of Americans. Unfortunately, most Americans.
But where do you back that up with fact? I mean, you're kind of basing that on your opinion of fat people, that they're just lazy. Do you know of any studies that say that fat people are fat because they're gluttonous and greedy and lazy?
Well, I that's like saying, do I know? That's the equivalent of saying, do you believe that 1 + 1 = 2? Anybody that's been in the health industry knows calories in equals calories out.
That's not exactly true either. Metabolism is based on many different complicating factors, including genetics.
You show me right now, Shannon. You show me right now. Okay, everybody wants to. The first thing the big fat acceptance groups do is they point out that there's two or three medical conditions where people put weight on, and then you see those people on the Life Channel. The overwhelming amount of people, 99% of people that are large, consume too much calories and don't burn off enough. And you know what? And all anybody has to do is go look at their relatives, whether it's a large aunt, large mom, big sister, and say, wow, she eats too much and she doesn't work out enough.
Okay, but you're also dealing with an environment that has calorically dense foods that are cheaper than the nutritionally dense foods that are available. So people, especially...
So you're saying that poverty is the reason people are large.
I poverty and obesity are very tightly correlated. I mean,
Really? How come in depression, Shannon? I just watched the History Channel the other night. Great one on the depression. I didn't see fat people.
Yeah, that's because there wasn't the same food industry that we have today where food is readily available. It's long-term shelf life. Makes it possible to make food cheaper. Food availability is there, and the fat people that you're talking about during the Great Depression, or I'm assuming you'd also cite the Holocaust, the people that survived were the fat people. They were the people that had the genetic tendency to hold on to every calorie. That's part of the genetics of obesity.
Shannon, so you're telling me that poor people can't make choices. So you're saying poor people...
Yeah, I'm saying if you don't have the money for food, then no, your choices are limited, especially if you live in a neighborhood that doesn't have a grocery store, but you have to buy instead at like a little quickie stop, which doesn't have fresh fruits and vegetables.
Man, how much Kool-Aid do you drink each day? Because I got to tell you, we treat many poor people. We
really?
Take care of many poor people, yeah. We do a lot
of
pro bono work.
How many poor people can afford gym memberships?
Hold on, Shannon. I just told you I do many pro bono people. I also have to tell you, Shannon, that your ideas of quoting these, they don't have available groceries in the areas. Do you know that when they have school programs, because I've studied this probably more than anybody, when they put food programs in inner city schools, okay, for the parents and the kids to eat healthy, they don't make the choice of taking the healthy vegetables and what have you. They take the garbage food. The bottom line is to base it on a economic issue is a load of garbage. They go for the easy decision because they're being lazy.
No, they go for the easy decision because they get more calories per punch for their dollar. They get more calories per penny when they go for the calorically dense foods, which helps them survive and helps the food last longer. That's
oh really? Well, you know, you believe that with the Cheetos and the Ring Dings. I'll tell you what, you can make a lot of potatoes go a long way.
Yeah, but you know
what? The Irish did it forever.
You can't make them cheap unless you process them. A bag of potatoes is more expensive than a bag of potato chips.
And they're a lot more calorically. You know what? You can last a bag of potato chips a lot less than the bag of potatoes. And you know what? I'm a Polish guy. And boy, you should see what my grandmother made do when she came over here. with the amount of food that she had in terms of cabbage. You can go amazing time on cabbage, Shannon.
Okay, but so you're again, talking about fresh foods.
Your argument might work with Richard Simmons type of style, but it doesn't work with facts. And the facts are is that if you want to be lean, if you don't want to be obese, you can eat very healthily on a low budget. And you know what? They choose the junk food. They choose the fast food because they're lazy. It's no different than the bum saying he's an alcoholic because that's all he can afford with his money he gets from panhandling as a booze.
You know, it's kind of funny that you bring up laziness and, you know, obesity is obviously tied to race. People use that same excuse for race, like why are black people so poor? Well, it's because they're lazy. They don't want jobs. So how
you're going to compare fat people to black people? That is unbelievable. And you know what?
I'm asking what the difference is. That.
Well, I'm not even answer that one with any dignity. Dignify that question.
Sure.
You want to compare black people to fat people? That's kind of. I mean, here's the thing, Shannon. Obesity affects whites, blacks, mulattoes, pink. If you're yellow, if you're green, if you're blue, it's because you're lazy. It has nothing to do with your color. Nothing to do with your sexuality. Not if you're a Republican, a Democrat, or if you're a Ron Paul supporter. It only affects people that are lazy, they're chubbies, they don't want to accept accountability, and there's plenty of people with no money that are lean and take care of themselves. They go out. It doesn't cost anything to go outside and run, Shannon.
If you live in a dangerous neighborhood where your life can be in danger going for a walk, then no, you're not going to be able to just go outside and take a walk. Okay, let me ask you this. You've talked about school interventions and them not making good choices. There's been three major intervention studies that have been done, one on Native American students, one across four states with various demographics, and one in Massachusetts for first or third graders. They all took excessive steps, extreme steps to curb obesity. They improved the nutrition. They increased the amount of gym classes. They improved nutrition education. They took all the steps that people have been advocating for. And do you know what they found? They found that although they improved the nutrition IQ of the children and they improved their nutrition choices, they did not reduce their BMI at all, except Somerville, which reduced an average of 1 pound. But the rest of them had no reduction in weight loss. So here's my question. What happens if we make all these drastic changes that you propose in order to save us from obesity, and instead of it making us thin, it makes us healthy but still fat?
Well, you know, before I answer that, the most important thing you're not getting from those studies that you quoted is the increased gym education.
And I just said that was included.
No. Gym education is not physical hours. That means kids are actually in a classroom learning about education, and kids are learning about nutrition.
No,
the majority of the time was physical education.
Are you talking about pathways?
Okay, and so, for example, in Texas, that is one of the biggest child obesity states that has been modeled out there, they actually decreased their child obesity over 10% because they require that the education be physical, not in a classroom, not from a teacher learning about the ideas.
The studies I'm citing added physical education, not in classes. They increased the amount of outdoor time and recess time. They increase the amount of physical activity the kids participate in during a day.
Very small and sparingly, Shannon. Look at the studies, and it quotes physical education.
Are you talking about the pathway
physical
study?
Activity.
Are you talking about
physical
the pathway study?
Physical education is not physical activity.
Okay,
and
so
now here's.
You're saying this like you know the studies I'm talking about. Are you referring to the Pathways study, the Catch study, or the Shape Up Somerville study?
Shannon, what I'm trying to tell you is right now, and if you let me finish without interrupting me here, is there's about 50 studies every 2 weeks done on obesity. And with fat acceptance groups and like the magazines that you represent, you quote the studies that are no documentation. They're so poor.
I will gladly send you the studies.
Because you know what? Here's the thing. Not only do I put my mouth where it is, I put my money. Okay, I spend hundreds of thousands of dollars getting child obesity laws attempted to be passed in Colorado. They're finally getting some of those things done that we worked on 2 to 3 years ago. So I had to look at all the different states and all the different studies. You wouldn't believe some of the studies that are done with – they're not double-blinded studies. They are not at all done with experts in the field. They're done by educators that have a hidden background with unions and what have you. So you have to then look at the studies where they come from.
But the same thing can be said for studies that talk about the dangers of obesity with white hat bias, where they're not reporting studies that don't show the negative correlations that you're referring to. By the way, they're correlations, not causations. There's no study that shows a causation between obesity and heart disease or any of those. That it's correlation.
Well, you go talk to, here's the thing, you go get a cardiologist that sees a lot of patients. You go get a sports doctor who's working on hips and other their knees and what have you. Mm-hmm. They'll laugh at you. They will laugh at you if you say obesity doesn't cause the hip issues, all these knee surgeries.
They may, until I mention that it's lifestyle and not obesity that causes the danger.
And they'll laugh at you. They will actually laugh at you and fall off the couch when you tell them that obesity doesn't cause heart problems. Just like you tried to tell me earlier that calories in and calories out doesn't have anything to do with obesity.
Well, okay, I mean, calories in, calories out, there have been studies shown that people will attempt to lose weight, and when they lose weight, if you start out heavier, then your body is less efficient at burning those calories. It's not simple calories in, calories out. And to act like it is to act like you're a math teacher rather than a nutritionist. And that's ridiculous.
Well, you know what, Shannon? I challenge any of your chubby people listening to come down and do my program where I put you on a meal plan, calories in, calories out, exact amount of protein based off your body fat, workout intensity level, age, and gender. And you will lose the weight. You will keep the
but
muscle.
But what if
you
don't
have,
want to lose the weight? What if you're only worried about is your health?
If you don't want to lose the weight, well, then you can be okay having diabetes 2 in your future. Then
okay,
you could
but
be
if
okay.
You're, if you improve your lifestyle choices and you're still fat, you can be healthy. Dr. Arya Sharma in Canada.
Now we're going down the angle of we're looking for Bigfoot again.
How about we look at the facts instead of the hyperbolic rhetoric that you choose to.
No, I'm still waiting for it. As I've said on Neil Cavuto, as I've said on Bulls and Bears and many other shows, I've waited for readers. Instead, they send me emails saying "screw you." But I always challenge Sasquatch, Bigfoot. If you're out there, that's the fat person that's in shape. Come on down. Let's see this big fat obese person.
You want me to find him? I will find him.
Hold on, right here. I challenge you right now, Shannon. You get me a person with a body fat above 30%. Because if you look at my what I've said is I'm not a big BMI person. The big thing I shoot for is body fats. I believe a body fat, as many other experts do, above 30% is obese.
Okay.
You get me a person with a body fat above 30% that can go run a marathon in under 3.5 hours, that can bench press their body weight times 2, okay, that can – we'll give you a whole measurable of different studies, physical things, and tests. I'll put you 25 push-ups in 30 seconds. They're not out there. They're not in shape. It's a load of malarkey.
I will see who I can find that would be up for that challenge because I know that they're out there. I know that there are people who are fat and extremely healthy. They take care of their bodies, and they've gained weight due to medication, due to stress, due to all sorts of different factors that –
stress? How about – you know, that's the other one we hear. We hear that it's their genes, and then we hear it's stress. What's really funny is the people – you brought up the Holocaust camps. I'll bring up the people in Sudan. Okay, or how about the people in Burma? They're stressed as hell, Shannon, but they're all skinny.
Do they have access to food? The people in Burma are under a repressive regime. The people in Sudan are starving. It's the same situation as the Holocaust. These people are starving, so the ones who survive are the ones that hang on to average calorie who are genetically predisposed to survive a famine. That's what fat people today are. And do you know what the average weight gain has been in the last 30 years? 7 to 9 pounds. This is what you're freaking out about. The biggest change has come from BMIs over 40. That's where the biggest weight gain has increased. And those are the people that have the genetic predisposition to hang on to every calorie, and so they're being affected by the toxic environment. But anyways, healthcare costs.
Well, you know what, Shannon? You could talk to any person that does body fats every day like I do, and they would, again, laugh. The body fats I see on people just keep going higher and higher and higher.
Even though for the last 10 years, based on
the information age, we have more information available,
the last
more
10
technology.
Years, women and children
and
have
food,
not
by
increased.
The way, food is cheaper today than it was 100 years
That's
ago in the argument of John Malthus.
That's the problem.
So for the argument that you use about food being cheap, it is so cheap in terms of what we can eat today, which is why they stuff their face because they
but
can buy
not,
more of it.
Not Whole Foods. Whole Foods are not
Whole
cheap.
Whole Foods, based on, if you compare it to 100 years ago and the cost of foods back then, based on the per capita income, is less expensive. They choose to make bad decisions with their food, and that leads to the problems with their body.
Okay.
And now, if you quoted it, you're saying that people, some people can't even have access to go run because it's so dangerous and
yeah,
the environment so bad. Okay. I don't know about you. I've lived in some major ghettos in my life. I lived in East Providence where my car got broken into each day. Every day there were shootings. I went running each day. Maybe I was crazy. Okay. Maybe I was a little bit scared. I was lucky nothing happened to me. But you know what? You can also do something in your apartment, which is what I used to do. I used to do plenty of sit-ups and push-ups and what have you. I lived in some bad neighborhoods in New York, very bad ones. I went running. So I don't get this. And you know what? I actually was in Chicago, and I ran. People thought I was nuts when I ran in some of the bad spots there in the South Side. So I don't understand that people in this country can say that they're terrified to go outside and run.
Everybody in this country is saying that. I'm saying that's why the correlation between poverty and obesity. I want to talk about healthcare costs you brought up. It's estimated at $147 billion. Yet you say you read the studies. Did you read that study?
Yeah, I didn't want to told you. It's $150 billion right. from 11% of our total healthcare costs. It was 6% in 1998.
Right. What is that based on? Is that based on weight, or what is that cost based on?
That is based on surgeons determining what was the reason that these people were treating. People were treated due to obesity.
The people that were cited in that study as being obese, they took all of the results of metabolic diseases that people turned up in hospitals for metabolic diseases or sought treatment for metabolic diseases. So even if you had a heart attack and you were thin, it was counted as obesity because it's just assumed that if you have a heart attack, you must be fat. So that study's flawed. But let me ask you about this one. Alcohol costs
according to you, Shannon. But
let's just say $147 billion. That's a gross amount. It's horrible. Alcohol abuse costs $45 billion a year in healthcare costs. It kills 85,000 people a year, including other people. It's not just when you get drunk, drink and drive. You're not just harming yourself. You're harming other people. You advocate alcohol use and marijuana use among your clients. So why shouldn't we step in and take these draconian measures to alcohol? After all,
I don't recommend. Let's get this straight. I do say you can drink and you can smoke a joint and still look good and feel good. Mm-hmm. However, it's called moderation. I also don't tell you not to eat. You can eat, Shannon. Mm-hmm. Alcoholics, if you watch any of my clips on Fox or any of my other interviews in the past, I compare being fat to an alcoholic. Because alcoholics and fat people are very similar. They're addicts. The food addict, the fat person is a food addict. The alcoholic is the alcohol addict. Neither one is acceptable. I'd have no problem wearing a shirt instead of saying no chubbies, no alcoholics. And by the way, if you smoke pot too much, you'll stuff your face too much and you'll get fat and you'll be in the same situation as the obese person. So it's called moderation. You can eat. I'm not saying don't eat. I don't believe in anorexia on the other side. And you can drink, and you can smoke a joint, but too much of something is too bad.
Okay,
just look at Tiger Woods for further example.
You're citing that addiction, alcohol addiction, and you're saying that it's the same as food addiction. Addiction is a genetic property. It's a genetic condition, and it's something that people have to struggle against. And yet,
consider food like Zach for chubby people. Chubby people eat most of the time. If you've ever spent a lot of time with fat people, Shannon, you'll find that they don't eat because they're hungry. They eat because they're looking to alter their moods. And what do? Instead of getting Prozac or Wellbutrin, they reach for the cupboards, grab a piece of cake, a candy bar. They get the temporary fix that feels good, which is why we also, if you quoted my website, is what I refer to the process as mental size. People need to work on their mental and their physical attitudes if they want to change their obesity.
So with two-thirds of the country overweight or obese and our pharmacological environment saying that almost everybody is on some kind of medication, including antidepressants, you're saying that the antidepressants that they're using aren't working, so they're eating? I mean, I'm not really sure what you're going for there as far as self-medication. I mean,
well, you know what? Anybody that's fat and is listening to this, and anybody that knows anybody that's fat and is listening to this will agree and will understand me completely. Fat people don't eat because they're hungry. They're not really hungry going for the 10th slice of pizza.
Isn't that basically an assumption? Isn't that a stereotype? I mean, you're not really – how do you know when a person is eating that they're not eating because they're hungry?
Let me ask you a question, Shannon. When you see a girl, mm-hmm. that's 65, 70 pounds, is it a stereotype to say that she is not consuming a lot of food, okay? Is that a stereotype? Is someone suffering from malnutrition?
I think it would be a stereotype. I think to assume that anybody's body shape is based solely on their diet is a stereotype.
Well, Shin, I don't know how you – I don't even know how you would survive in life. If I see the stove is throwing off smoke and fire, I'm going to assume that there's something wrong with it, and I'm going to turn it off.
Okay.
You have to
talking
make assumptions
in life. Talking about a mechanical device and a human being are two different things. You're
no,
you,
because
– You talk about human beings like they're mechanical devices, calories in, calories out. They're not
yep,
mechanical
devices.
Yes, they
are. You know what?
They are biological creatures that have very
biological
complex
creatures.
Do
you know what? Shannon, they are very simply, if you are fat and you are listening, you could be sexy as hell. Just stop eating so much and work out.
But
get yourself
who
on an
says
accountability
that a fat person
program.
Isn't sexy just because you say it? You know, I don't think short
well,
people are sexy, but, you know, I think that, you know. Well, let me ask you this. What is your BMI? I'm just
no,
kidding.
No, no. You go back. You brought up a can of worms right there, Shannon.
Okay, so we've covered the issues and haven't really gotten anywhere. So I decided to take a more direct route. The next half covers subjects that appeared in an article in the magazine 5280, which is a Colorado monthly magazine. And I decided to ask him about the things that came up in this article. And it got pretty personal at times, and I see it as acceptable in this case. It's not something I would typically do, except for the fact that Michael Karolchyk is such a unrepentant jackass. He's a prototypical dickweed, and I see no problem with going after a dickweed for being a dickweed toward people for no other reason than personal profit. So I asked him a few personal questions, and his responses, we'll get a look at that. But first, for a frame of reference for a part in the interview where I falsely accuse Michael Karolchyk of being short, which is based on the following host segment from Mystery Science Theater, is where I got the idea of short man's disease. It seemed to fit Michael Karolchyk. So what you're about to listen to kind of begs the question, can you have short man's disease and not be short?
Hi everyone, Mike Nelson here on Satellite Love.
Hey man.
Oh, hey sir.
What are you saying? I'm short, huh? What?
No, I was gonna ask where you've been.
Oh, well, I had karate, then I swung by the gym to lift. Because I had some extra time before picking up my hot new girlfriend, Christy, who will most likely wear her thong as she clings to me in the back of my Harley. Yeah. We're going to make out in public a little.
Servo, you look different. Hey, you've got lifts in your hover skirt, don't you?
Hey, man, watch what you're saying there, man.
You do. You have lifts in your hover skirt.
All right, that's it. Come
hey,
on.
Hey,
whoa,
take
whoa,
it
whoa.
Easy. Take easy. It easy. Tom, I'm afraid you've got short man's disease.
What?
Okay, it's the tendency for height challenge males to overcompensate for a perceived lack of machismo.
So what are you saying? I'm short, huh?
Yeah, I'm afraid that is implicit.
Oh, man.
No problem though. We just rub a little baby aspirin
oh, no.
on your
oh,
gums,
no.
and you'll be fine.
No,
no, you'll fine.
No, no, no.
There, that's better. We'll be right back.
Can I keep my nubchucks?
We'll see, honey.
Violent
oh,
shrimp,
little
God.
Baby short man. We'll see.
You know what? No, I don't think, again, everybody says they have an idea of beauty. Well, I have to tell you, from the days of the Roman statues and the days of the Greek statues, there and the ideas of Pygmalion didn't make this large, big woman.
Right.
That isn't beautiful.
Right. What
okay.
about the Venus of Willendorf? That's a piece of art. those are found all over cultures throughout the world, celebrating bigger women. And let me ask you this: How come the
porn industry isn't thriving with large, big women, Shannon?
How come your porn industry didn't thrive, Michael?
How come when Jack in the Box or any of the food industries or GoDaddy want to make a big splash with their marketing, they use hot girls?
Well, maybe because for the past 40 years, the message has been thin is sexy. And if there's, but here's the thing: not everybody finds fat women sexy and not sexy. In fact. Do you happen to know who Pierce Brosnan is married to?
I had no idea. I'm not a Pierce Brosnan fan.
Kelly Shea Smith, who is regularly beaten the crap out of in the media for being fat, he loves her body. He talks about her body. He married her when he was fat. Pierce Brosnan could have any woman he wants, and he chose her. So what?
Well, Shannon, if you looked at Fox News Channel study a week ago, 6% of Americans think that Elvis is still alive, and 5% of Americans think that the moon landing was faked.
Okay.
So you know what? I'm sure there are some crackpots out there that think that fat women are sexy. Absolutely.
But you say no chubby, no hubby. There is no shortage of fat women getting married in this country. You are operating under a delusion.
There's a lot of illegal immigrants that are looking to get in the country that are trying
you're
to
praying,
get their
You're preying on low self-esteem. You're preying on low self-esteem. Yes, you are. You're telling people that if you don't get thin, you'll never get married. And that's just not true. That's bullshit.
Shannon, now, if you tell me this right now, first off, if you are skinny or lean or looking good, you improve the pool. If you want to marry a rich, hot guy that's got his stuff together, that takes care of himself, or a big, fat guy, you have increased your pool. But if you're large and obese, if you're large and obese, your options are very limited. Who's going to marry you? Because the guy that's in shape, that works out, takes care of himself, and is well-educated, he's going to go, "You're lazy and undisciplined, young lady. I ain't going to marry you."
You know, I find it kind of ironic that you use this whole, like, threat of marriage, this threat of loneliness and singlehood to kind of get people to come into your gym when you've been divorced 2 times. So it kind of seems like who wants to stay with you know, a person who's got such an outsized personality that's so uncompassionate, completely bigoted and
I have been
hateful.
Divorced twice, Shannon. You're absolutely right. And, you know, each time I've upgraded, I've got the most beautiful woman right
upgraded?
Now.
Upgraded?
I've upgraded.
You're referring to women like Mars.
You're saying, you've said that my attitude is terrible and unattractive. I've said, you know what? I've upgraded each time. And I don't stay. And here's the thing, no chubbies. In those relationships, the ladies were lazy and making excuses and weren't living up to their potential. No chubbies.
If she doesn't live up to the Michael Karolchyk standard. Tell me something. Who chucked who to the curb in those 2 divorces?
In both cases, I made the final decision. Absolutely.
Okay.
In the last relationship, that's not only my opinion. That's the paper trail, if you care to follow it.
Okay. Well, speaking of paper trails, you talk about how you want to impose heavy taxes on sugary foods to combat obesity. Research shows that soda taxes have not worked in the 33 states that they've reduced consumption slightly, but as far as reducing BMIs, it's negligible. So I find it interesting that you're wanting to approach this from a tax angle. You're a noted libertarian, right-wing, kind of non-tax person, non-interventionist, and yet you want to use taxes as a motivator. But I wanted to ask you, don't you think that's kind of hypocritical, considering that you had your Curtis Street gym closed down with 2 tax liens on it, and you were evicted from your Cherry Creek facility for not paying rent?
I wasn't evicted from my Cherry Creek facility for not paying rent. I was evicted from my Cherry Creek facility for 3 violations, including having a protest, and then 2 other violations.
A protest that you staged yourself.
I had many protests, including some I staged myself for marketing. Absolutely, those are all well documented. And with a tenant issue below downstairs. And so that is incorrect. Your source is wrong on that. Now,
the source is the newspaper article where they got a copy of the check.
Hey, Shannon, then everything we read in the newspaper is true. I guess, you know what, Obama really isn't a citizen in the United States. I have to believe everything I read.
Was there not a check bounced for $20,000?
Well, you know what, that was back in August, and I was there until March. Okay. So, you might want to get your facts straight. As far as you
tax
bring up the IRS and tax liens or whatever, Mr. Karolchyk is anti-gym, and Mr. Karolchyk's anti-gym revolution has never been hit with a tax lien. Mr. Karolchyk's BBMK, I've owned over 20 companies.
Weren't your facilities under your father-in-law's name?
No, that's another lie. So, again, where do you get your sources from?
I'm okay. So nothing that's ever been reported on you in the newspaper that's negative is true.
Well, you know what, Shannon? That's very easy to state. Anybody that's listening can go look and see that the IRS sees BBNK. They never seize the anti-gym. They never seize the anti-gym revolution. Oops, that's another thing you don't have your facts on.
So that's
as far as saying
the fact that you had almost $200,000 in taxes.
Shannon, hold on. Shannon, as far as you saying my father-in-law had my facilities, I had my facilities 3 years before I met my second wife. Oops, again, these are all things that you don't have your stuff together, Shannon. You got to get that stuff together.
That may be, but I find it
Oops, I'm sorry. That may be.
You're defending yourself.
And by the way, why are you bringing this up, Shannon? How does this help your argument? Anybody that's listening to this, it's kind of cheap that first off, you're wrong. Uh-huh. Second off, you're trying to go out there at me personally instead of arguing the points. You seem to be losing the points, so you argue this stuff personally.
No, I'm going personally because you want to go after taxes. You want to go after people for personal accountability. You want to go after people because you say they're lazy and they're irresponsible. Well, I find your attitude and behavior irresponsible and lazy. I think that not.
And I paid the piper for it, big guy.
You have almost $200,000 in back taxes.
And here's the thing, that is not true, Shannon. And again, if you did your research, it was almost $48,000, and the rest was interest payments. And I've worked out a payment plan.
No, wait a second. I thought you just said the IRS never came after your gym.
They came after BBMK. And BBMK has made its payments, and I've never been convicted. I've never done anything illegal, tax evasion, or whatever, Shannon.
Well, congratulations
on
that.
Being called late on a payment, which many Americans are late. Look at all the tax commercials on TV. Oh, my God, yeah, taxes. We're all in this type of economy, what have you, and I made good on it. So you need to get your facts straight, Shannon. Wow. Woo.
Maybe my facts are wrong, but I think Occam's Razor says it might be the impetus on you, considering your own mother called you a liar in an article. She thinks that you're a liar, your mom. Now, if that doesn't...
And you know what? Why don't you call my mother up right now and ask her, Shannon, if she believes that. She has been on numerous interviews since then saying that the reporter took her words out of context.
Oh, okay.
And you know what? So you need... In that same article, you quote my mom said, my God, he smokes marijuana and he has asthma. I mean, come on, Shannon. Again, though, how does this help you? We're talking about major issues affecting our health care costs.
Uh-huh.
We're talking about major issues affecting potential taxes, which are a major issue, and you're going after things like, did your father-in-law help you?
Mm-hmm.
Did your first two wives leave you, or did you leave them? Isn't that kind of silly?
This is about credibility.
Do you want to know about my sex life next?
Well, that seems to be something that is of interest to you with your clients, especially considering the notes that were found in the dumpster outside your gym, which were highly confidential and included notes on their sex lives. So why would me asking you about your sex life be off topic since you seem to, use that
as a
bludgeon against
your clients? They weren't my notes, Shannon. As you know, the source that you also are on that one, anybody can go look at, they were another trainer's notes. And you know what? I had no access to the dumpster. And if you wanted to look at
still,
it, and
you're the owner of the club.
No,
you're responsible
Shannon, you just
for that.
Said, you just you. No, I'm not. When the IRS seized my gym, you get 1 hour to leave, Shannon.
Mm-hmm.
So maybe you wanted me to break in and break the law. I was removed. I had no access to any of that stuff or what have you. Again, wrong. Oops.
Are you
getting any of your stuff right?
Wow.
Any of this right?
You're right. I'm so ashamed of myself for doing research and finding article after article
research,
after article.
No, you just regurgitate.
After
Shannon,
article after article.
You regurgitate the CBS article, which CBS, you have no idea, for all the people listening, for 1 year I made fun of CBS, called them the Chubby Broadcast System in Denver. I used to be
Why
their
did you
fitness
do that?
Contributor. Hold on. I used to be their fitness contributor, and then I went to war with their manager, Walt DeHaven. A whole war. Now, why didn't ABC, NBC, or any of these other stations run the stories that were complete lie and falsehoods and innuendo? Because CBS wanted to go after me. They thought I was done.
And did
they thought
you sue
Mr.
them?
Mr. Karolchyk was over with and he would never have a forum.
Did you sue them for libel? That seems like pretty easy to prove libel if they're just making stuff up about you. Why didn't you take them to court?
We actually do have something in the works, and I will not comment on it further, but we do have something in the works. It's a beautiful law in Colorado where you have 3 years to take care of damages. and we have something major. As you know, CBS has deep pockets. I had to rebuild my company and retake things and prove the damage that they caused me. And guess what? I'll be getting mine very shortly.
I look forward to hearing that.
Yeah. Oh, you know what? I'm sure you will.
I hope that your other ventures go better than, you know, your Denver gyms, your Sexcellence, your CBS reality show. I hope that you don't fail as much as you already have.
Oh, well, you know what, Shannon? I don't think I failed at all. I think actually in this past year that my audience has grown. I've done more Fox News broadcasts, more national broadcasts than I ever have in other arenas. And all the people that hate me and what have you, you guys want to talk about my sex life. You want to talk about my – I mean, why wouldn't you call my father-in-law himself and ask him that question? That's the most ridiculous thing. As a good reporter, you would call my father-in-law. He would laugh at you. I mean, well, how did he give me money when I didn't even meet him until 2006? That's a good one, but hey, that's kind of nice. So there, it's when people don't do their research,
uh-huh.
And then they make these innuendos. We see this in the Tiger Woods.
Right.
Everybody wants to forget all the money that Tiger Woods gave and all the charities and everything he does. Let's just keep ripping him and look at his personal life. We won't even talk about his golf.
So you're saying that if you do lots of good charity work on the side, you should ignore any improprieties in your personal life?
No, Shannon, what we said is that we wouldn't have an interview about obesity. You can't win the argument, so you talk about my
I can win the argument. It's just you keep
you
when I bring up a study, you basically dismiss the study. When I bring up a research, you say, "Oh, well, that's just people, they're not doing enough research, blah blah blah." You're dismissive. You don't actually acknowledge the facts, and then you pretend that it's me that doesn't have my facts right.
And Shannon, you know what? Here's the thing. You couldn't win the argument, so you bring up my two ex-wives. Wow, Michael, I got
well,
you.
Yeah, because you're talking about
how you bring up the same article that has been discredited since because you've done such faulty research.
Who's it been discredited
okay.
by?
Oh my God, there are so many different people that have fun with that and plugged it and what have
Who?
You.
Like where? Can you send me any links to? I'd love to read stuff.
You know what, Shannon? If I cared about it enough, I would. But would you? You think Tiger Woods is going to start sending you links to prove his innocence? I don't have to prove anything.
Well, you contacted me.
Shannon, you contacted me. Mm-hmm. I don't need to prove a negative. I don't need to prove that my father-in-law, for example, who I didn't meet until 3 years, after I met my second wife, 3 years, he gave me money and all this other stuff for my businesses. The anti-gym and the BBMK and all my other companies were formed before I met my father-in-law.
Okay.
And all but one of my companies were formed before my second wife.
All right. So
those are just
reporters
outright
are obviously screwing things up. So what about how you claim to graduate from Brown University and you didn't graduate from there?
Really? Well, that's news to me. Who's your proof? Who's your proof? Again, who's your proof?
All right, how about I contact
the
reporter
register.
That called
Did you call the register? No, you didn't.
Yeah,
did
the
you?
Guy from Brown, the guy that did the article in 5280.
Oh, the guy that did the article. So you're quoting another blog and again.
It's not
so
a
again,
blog.
Shannon,
it's a newspaper. It's a newspaper. The guy.
Oh, a newspaper. Which one?
5280.
That's not a newspaper. That's a blog. It's 5280.com.
Okay.
Again, you're wrong. Shannon, can you get your stuff together? You're quoting blogs, and you're saying they're newspapers.
Okay,
this
well, how about,
I mean.
how about I
hey,
contact
Shannon,
that reporter?
I'm also going to tell you the following, too. Uh-huh. I've been accused of running to Mexico and running a drug traffic trade. Some blogs have also – my clients send me these. They're very funny. I've also been accused of running a gold operation. Mm-hmm. I've also been accused of taking all of my money from past nightclubs and sending it to Colombia, where I can meet more drug barons.
Right.
I've also been told that I'm on steroids, that I used to be a woman, and now I'm a man. Come on, Shannon. You're better than this, aren't you? What kind of reporter are you?
Hey, I'm just basing this on previously exposed facts about your career.
Oh, from blogs and haters. Wow. Woo! Man,
well, okay.
That's good reporting.
When you agreed to do the interview with 5280, it's a blog. You did an interview with them. It's not like he just dug up a bunch of stuff on you. He interviewed you for two hours.
He did not interview. I mean, if you actually went to our website, I have a whole radio interview that discusses that. The reporter said he would never. The conditions signed by 5280 were never to contact family members. A, B, that I would have an interview chance with him based on the people that I gave him permission to talk to. He never did the interview with me. I have emails that show that the reporter refused to do the interview with me. He called my mother. He even put it in his own blog that he broke the deal, but he didn't care.
In the same blog
that you quote that my TV show didn't happen, it's funny how you pick out facts that you think are facts, whatever. He acknowledged that I was under contract with the TV reality show.
And then it was canceled.
It wasn't canceled. I've re-upped the contract with them. So, again, you don't have your facts.
When's that coming out?
If you know anything about media companies, Shannon, and the way networks work, I can't even
release hush,
that.
Hush, hush. I'm sorry. I didn't realize it was hush, hush. When that reporter talks about meeting you for drinks, going out to dinner with you, he just made that up too?
He didn't do any interview. When he went out for the drinks, he actually interviewed two of my lobbyists that were doing the childhood obesity thing. The lobbyists made him take off his tape recorder because as lawyers, they did not want to talk to him.
That's kind of weird because
you don't have your facts straight. You got to get your facts straight, Shannon.
Okay, well, clearly, Michael Karolchyk, I have underestimated you. I have just grabbed stuff out of the air, pulled it out of my ass, and I've completely railroaded you. I apologize. I am extremely, heartily sorry. This will probably I will spend days regretting this interview. Days, possibly
months. I doubt that. I know you're being facetious, but I will hope in the future when you do interviews with people. That when you're losing the points, you don't go to the lengths of bringing up ex-wives and asking who broke up with who, and then quoting blogs. Please, I'm a little bit better than blogs, Shannon. I think one of the most important things, one of the happiest things I've been called is Ann Coulter of fitness. There's actually been some really good pieces from
Newsweek
and Time magazine. Newsweek and Time magazine, credible sources that have slammed me, or the Boston Herald, good sources that have slammed me. Mm-hmm. For you to use a blog as your information, pretty sad.
I'm ashamed of myself. I should really
pretty sad, buddy.
So, but you know you've compared yourself to Howard Stern and Holden Caulfield. So.
I didn't compare myself to Howard Stern. The Dom and Jane show put me on their show and called me the Howard Stern Fitness again. You are wrong again.
And you compared your fight to of obesity to the civil rights movement and the American Revolution? Is that
I say I'm a revolutionary, absolutely, in this industry.
You said, do you think I didn't piss off those cocksuckers, or that we didn't piss off the cocksuckers in Britain for throwing the tea into the port? You compared your fight. You have a self-aggrandizement issue, and I think you have short man's disease, too, which is a tendency for a high-challenge male.
Well, I'm almost 6 foot tall, so I don't know how I have short man's disease, but whatever you think. I'm almost 6 foot tall. I'm 5'11 and a half.
Really?
Yeah. Sorry, big guy. Oops.
Oh, man.
Again, so you thought, Shannon, do you have anything right? You think I'm short? You're unbelievable, my friend. Is there anything else you want to talk about, my foot size girlfriends?
No, I think that about covers it. I think that, you know, you have a history of telling not the whole truth to reporters, and you'll do anything to cover your tracks.
Oh, I'll tell you what, Shannon, and anybody that's listening to this podcast, just think about how reporters like Shannon, when they get their cards called out, then bring out their hatchets. Legitimate reporters who do their research, and I have no problems. I have many good reporter relationships, but people that just want to pick out stuff, and for everybody listening, Shannon said he wanted to talk about obesity and talk about fat bias. Instead, it's talking about ex-wives, ex-father-in-laws, and penis sizes. Kind of silly.
I don't think I went after your penis size. I don't really want to think about your penis.
Okay, penis size, okay? And then you also talk about my height. Oh, my gosh.
By the way, everybody out there,
is 5'11".
Are you hoping that I'm going
to... You know, it's 5'11 and a half.
The great thing about this podcast, I can just turn down the volume. Are you hoping that I'm going to talk about your penis size? Because I didn't mention your penis once in this interview.
Because the same 5280 blog that you do, anybody that writes about blogs says there's no chubbies mean something sexually or what have you. That's like the biggest line. Or the other one is that I'm a bald mother effer. So, I mean, come on. I'm surprised we didn't get there to those 2 points.
I just think that if anything, you've got some kind of, I don't know, some kind of issue with women going down that makes you need this trophy wife that's so perfect.
Well, you know what, Shannon, why don't you answer this for me before you go? Because I'd like to hear your opinion on this.
Sure.
You came and sought me. Mm-hmm. The networks come and seek me, from Fox to CNN to local affiliates to I have done over 30 international radio broadcasts this year, and they come to me. Mm-hmm. Now, if I am such a bad, evil guy, okay, who doesn't know what he's talking about, then why'd you come to me like all the rest of them, Shannon?
Well, because the article I'm writing is actually about fat hatred, and you are possibly one of the most contemptible, irresponsible, and hateful people I've ever seen talk about fat. So you just seem like a really good source for this particular article. As far as the rest of the people, you're sensational. You know, you say stupid things, you say ignorant things on
stupid
television.
Things.
Yeah,
mm-hmm.
you belittle fat people, you wear a stupid shirt. So what are you, no fatties next? What, no plumpers? It's just, you're so ridiculous. You're a sideshow, you're a clown, and really
uh-huh.
nobody gives you any credibility.
And nobody's treated more fat people and gotten better results than me.
Tell me something.
That's the facts, and that's the breaks, and you know what? We can sit here saying who's got the bad break, you or me in life, yada, 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 but what we can't deny is that the fat people break the most chairs, and they break the hearts.
See,
and
that's what you go back to. You go back to that bully mentality of I'm going to treat fat people and talk about them and make them feel like shit. And why? Probably because you feel like shit about yourself, and I can't blame you. Because
I do feel bad about myself, actually. You know what? I just missed my protein shake about 30 minutes ago, so I wouldn't put the blender on when you called me.
You know,
so
you missed your protein shake? Is that,
yeah,
was that a reference to why you were talking
shake.
About penises?
You know,
so
because
much?
I missed my protein shake, so I'm a little bit low, and I'm actually scared to go outside and run because, like you said, Shannon, someone might jump me. It's a terrible environment out here in San Diego with all the big chubbies running around.
Right. Okay. Well, it was nice talking to you, and I hope you get some dignity sometime soon. Take it easy, Michael.
Hey, Shannon, it was great talking to you, and no matter what your fifth girlfriend said from seventh grade, you're probably a nice guy.
I agree, and I don't think that you're the beef-headed mouth breather that most people say you are. So take it easy, Michael.
You know what? You have a nice day, Shannon. Good luck with the Fatty magazine.
Thanks. Bye.
So that was the interview, and as you can tell, it was pretty intense towards the end there. With he was really kind of backed into a corner, I think, and as a result, he just lied over and over and over and over and over and about the weirdest shit. Like, Robert Sanchez of 5280 hadn't really interviewed him. Like, he just made all this stuff up about meeting him for dinner and working out at his club. We have actually a bonus feature here on this particular podcast. The thing Michael Karolchyk seems to have forgotten is that a person can verify either before or after an interview. And it was my intention to verify this information anyways, but it did give me the opportunity to hear this.
Again wrong. Oops. What are
wow.
you getting any of your stuff right?
And this.
So you need to get your facts straight, Shannon. Wow. Woo.
And also this.
Quoting blogs. Please, I'm a little bit better than blogs, Shannon.
And I think you'll agree that this was probably the best one. So I guess let's start with the first one I verified, and that's Brown University. You'll recall that in response to my question, why did you lie about graduating from Brown University, he had this to say.
Really? Well, that's news to me. Who's your proof? Who's your proof? Again, who's your proof?
All right, how about I contact
the
reporter
register.
That called
Did you call the register?
Who's your proof, indeed. So I called the register, and and this is what she said.
Transcript office.
Yeah, I was wondering if I could verify the graduation status of one of your former students.
Okay, let me get into that screen.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, so it's Michael attended from the fall or September of 1990 through May of 1995.
Okay.
But has not received a degree.
No degree.
No.
No, but what about like an associate's or nothing at all?
They only get a bachelor's degree here, and he did not receive it.
Okay, great. Thank you very much.
Okay, bye.
Bye.
Liar, liar, liar.
Lie number one. So then I had to look into this.
I wasn't evicted from my Cherry Creek facility for not paying rent. I was evicted from my Cherry Creek facility for three violations.
for being too fucking badass. And when I asked him if he had bounced a $20,000 check, he told me this.
Well, you know what? That was back in August, and I was there until March. So, again, you might want to get your facts straight.
Not exactly a denial, but still claiming I don't have my facts straight. So I decided to call his landlord.
So basically, I wanted to verify the reasons why his facility was closed down in your property.
He didn't pay the rent.
Okay, because he claimed it wasn't because of the rent. When we spoke, he said that it was because of complaints about his. I don't know if it was because of the noise complaints or because of violations against your code or something.
He didn't pay the rent.
That was it.
That was it.
Okay, because he said it had nothing to do with the rent. Can you verify how much was owed upon?
No, but there was a lawsuit to get that back. So I mean, it's public record.
Okay. Was it a successful lawsuit for you?
We came to a settlement and
okay.
Know, so
okay, great.
Liar, liar, liar.
Lie numbers 2 and 3. On the tax issues, he said this.
As far as you tax bring up the IRS and tax liens or whatever, Mr. Karolchyk is anti-gym, and Mr. Karolchyk's anti-gym revolution has never been hit with a tax lien. Mr. Karolchyk's BBMK,
right,
I've owned over 20 companies.
And that's a lot. But did you have any liens against you?
Almost $200,000.
And here's the thing, that is not true, Shannon. And again, if you did your research, it was almost $48,000, and the rest was interest payments, and I've worked out a payment plan.
I'm like the Willie Nelson of fitness. So, anyways, all I did was call the county clerk's office, and this is what they had to say.
But on Karolchyk, there's I showed two tax liens in 2008.
Okay. Do you know the amounts? Is that public information?
Yeah. Okay. The one. Let me give you the reception number of the first one.
Okay.
2008.
Okay.
057.
Okay.
859.
Okay.
And that one is $115,978.56.
And can you tell how much of that is interest versus...
That I can't, because the IRS, I think, is the one that...
Okay.
This is the original amount, though, so...
Okay.
And then...
So if that's the original amount, does that include taxes? Or, I'm sorry, interest? Or no? Do you know?
No.
No?
No, because this is the original amount.
It doesn't include interest.
Not that I know of.
Okay. All right, what's the other one?
Okay, another one is 2008.
Uh-huh.
131.
Okay.
095. And that one is $68,100.20.
Wow. Okay. That's quite a hefty sum.
Liar! Liar! Liar!
Lie number 4. And now we get to the stupidest moment of the interview. I'm not really sure whether this is qualifies as a lie so much as just being a moron.
The guy that did the article in 5280.
Oh, the guy that did the article. So you're quoting another blog. And again,
it's not
so
a
again,
blog.
Shannon,
it's a newspaper. It's a newspaper. The guy.
Oh, a newspaper. Which one?
5280.
That's not a newspaper. That's a blog. It's 5280.com.
Okay.
Again, you're wrong, Shannon. Can you get your stuff together? You're quoting blogs.
So I had to verify whether 5280 was a blog or a newspaper.
This is Robert.
Hey, Robert. It's Shannon.
Yep.
Okay. So you wrote the article in 5280.
I did.
That exposed pretty much all the BS of Karolchyk's business.
Sure.
But do you think people can take you seriously since you're just a blog?
We're not really just a blog. We're the largest, I'm trying to think here, I think we're the largest regional magazine in the Rocky Mountains. Our circulation is... close to 100,000, I think. We're a monthly magazine. We're the magazine for Colorado, for Denver. I think, Kylie, I'm trying to remember all the stats, but I think the last 5 years, four or five times, we've been a finalist for the National Magazine Award, which is like the Pulitzer Prizes for magazines across the country, and it's not regional magazines, it's regionals. It's like GQ, Esquire, Sports Illustrated, all that good stuff. And yeah, so we're definitely not just a blog. In fact, we're probably one of the most recognized and most respected regional magazines in the nation.
All right.
Michael, just because something is a .com doesn't make it a blog, although it might qualify as a blog. And now, even more inexplicably, the worst lie of the night.
When that reporter talks about meeting you for drinks, going out to dinner with you, he just made that up too?
He didn't do any interview. When he went out for the drinks, he actually interviewed two of my lobbyists that were doing the childhood obesity thing. The lobbyists made him take off his tape recorder because as lawyers, they did not want to talk to him.
That's kind of weird
because
you don't have
your facts straight.
Yeah.
You got to get your facts straight, Shannon.
How do you even, like, how is this man even functional, let alone operating a financially, you know, successful company? It boggles the mind. So I asked Robert about this.
And I guess my next question is, how do you expect to produce an accurate article if you don't actually interview Michael Karolchyk in person?
Is this a trick question?
No, it's completely legitimate. Michael Karolchyk claims that you never interviewed him. You interviewed two of his lobbyists, and they wouldn't let you tape record anything.
Okay, let's see. I ate with him at the Capitol Grill restaurant here downtown about, I think, three times. I went to a party at a club with him and Carlos and a couple other people who's associated with, including Lisa, his then girlfriend. I don't know if they're still together. And then I went to Fox 31, the regional Fox affiliate out here, with him while he tried to hammer out something with a commercial. I think some folks had complained that, you know, it was a vulgar commercial or something like that. I was there with him. I worked out at his gym, I think, for 2 weeks. The one downtown, like straight downtown, and then I saw him several times at his gym, what was his gym, in Cherry Creek North, which is a really cool, swanky area. Hung out there. Our photographer took a lot of photos of him. He's emailed me about a billion times talking about my body mass index or whatever when I was working out at the gym. He used to make me really good protein shakes at the anti-gym, so I can definitely vouch for that. That guy knows how to make a protein shake.
All right. Well.
Oh, and he also drives around in a really nice Hummer,
yeah,
which is really cool. So.
All right, so I guess that's two things that I can't nail you for.
Liar, liar, liar.
So picture starting form of just who this man is and what he's capable of convincing himself. I mean, I don't know if he's if he believes these things or if he's just that desperate to save face. So there you go, lies number 5 and 6. I'm losing count. And now we start getting to the part of the interview where Michael Karolchyk proves just what a dickweed he is. When I asked about the part of the 5280 article where his mom called him a liar, he had this to say.
You know what? Why don't you call my mother up right now and ask her, Shannon, if she believes that. She has been on numerous interviews since then saying that the reporter took her words out of context.
Oh, okay.
And you should never tell me to call your mother to verify something, because I will.
Hello?
Hi, is this Pat Karolchyk?
Yes, it is.
So I called Pat up. Really, really cool lady. I'd like to hang out with Pat Karolchyk. How a woman this cool could produce such a tainted offspring? I don't know. But she's a really sweet lady, and I only wanted to ask her one question, and that was, had you spoken to any other reporters to refute the 5280 article? And this is what she said.
He told me that you had gone out, and after the last interview where a reporter contacted you, and you said that your son had lied, Michael had said that you had gone out and refuted that in the press since then. And I was just wondering, I looked for articles where you had been interviewed since then, and I couldn't find any. Is that true? Did you refute your previous statements?
Where are you calling from?
St. Louis. I'm sorry?
And what paper are you writing for?
It's Scorch Magazine.
Well, all I'm going to say to you is I never said ever in the beginning any time that my son was a liar. Mm-hmm. Okay?
Okay.
And I don't know what I supposedly said that it was a liar. The man, when he called me, I shouldn't have answered him, and I shouldn't be even talking to you because it's just, he told me that my son has no relationship with me because I was upset because he said I was obese on a radio station in Colorado. Mm-hmm. I can't even get to New York stations where I live. I don't know how the hell I got to Colorado.
I understand.
And that's exactly what I said to him.
Okay. And I'm not asking for any questions like that. I just wanted to verify, did you go later and talk to any
other
reporters?
I have never spoken to anyone, and I should never have spoken to that gentleman.
Liar! Liar! Liar!
Lie number five. However, to be fair, in this interview, I also had a chance to verify this.
You have a self-aggrandizement issue, and I think you have short man's disease, too, which is a tendency
for
a high-challenge male.
Well, I'm almost 6 foot tall, so I don't know how I have short man's disease, but whatever you think. I'm almost 6 foot tall. I'm 5'11 and a half.
Really?
Yeah, sorry, big guy. Oops.
Oh, man.
Again, so you thought, Shannon, do you have anything right?
So although I promised Mrs. Karolchyk that I wouldn't use any other part of our interview, because she went on for quite some time about several other personal issues of Michael's, but I wouldn't use it because I gave her my word. But, however, this part I will use because it does vindicate her son.
How tall is he, do you know?
He used to be. He used to be like 6 foot, 6'1", and 185 Jeez. Pounds.
You know, you just never know if a guy that lies this prolifically might just lie about his height, too. Which brings us to the coup de grace. No, coup de grace, sorry. Is that right? You're the one that's French. So, well, you'll recall that we discussed Michael's prior relationships, and about his second wife, he had this to say.
And here's the thing, no chubbies. In those relationships, the ladies were lazy and making excuses and weren't living up to their potential. No chubbies.
I think he's standing pretty firm on this.
I think you're right. I think he's demonstrated that he has a very low tolerance for chubbies, at the very least. So,
I love a good chubby myself.
Okay. Yeah. Maybe later on. Later on. Okay. So, I thought it was fair, considering his claim against his wife, that I could, you know, give her a call.
Yes, can I speak with Kelly Karolchyk, please?
This is Kelly.
I wonder what she's going to have to say about this.
He admitted that he was divorced twice, and then he said this about his former wives.
Uh-huh.
The ladies were lazy and making excuses and weren't living up to their potential. No chubbies.
Wow, and he said that about Camille and I, his
yes.
last week. Okay, we're both as skinny comes, and we're not lazy people
I've
at all.
I've seen your picture, yeah.
Liar! Liar! Liar!
And while we're here, I had to ask about this comment.
Tell me something. Who chucked who to the curb in those two divorces?
In both cases, I made the final decision. Absolutely.
Okay.
And that's
curious.
Even in the last relationship, that's not only my opinion. That's the paper trail, if you care to follow it.
Okay.
Let's check out that paper trail.
And then, and then I asked him, well, you know, who was responsible in the end for, like, who decided to go through with the divorce? Or, and he said, in both cases, I made the final decision, absolutely. He said, in the last relationship, referring to you, that's not only my opinion, but the paper trail, if you care to follow it.
Wow, that's amazing, because he left me. He's with that for Lisa. That's probably who he is right now.
Mm-hmm.
He was having an affair.
Okay.
Yeah. So, no, I didn't... Now, I had to do all the divorce paperwork, because he just took off and never did anything about it. And the state granted me a divorce after 3 months.
Okay.
But he did not. No, he did not.
Okay.
Liar! Liar! Liar!
So really, Michael, you chucked yourself to the curb, technically. And with so much class. Now on to more fact-based questioning. Regarding his father-in-law, he said several things. He said this.
Is your facilities under your father-in-law's name?
No, that's another lie. So, again, where do you get your sources from?
And this.
Aunt Shannon, as far as you saying my father-in-law had my facilities, I had my facilities 3 years before I met my second wife. Oops, again, these are all things that you don't have your stuff together, Shannon. You got to get that stuff together.
And this.
The anti-gym and the BBNK and all my other companies were formed before I met my father-in-law.
Okay.
And all but one of my companies were formed before my second wife.
So Kelly, shed some light on the subject for me.
I read in the article in 5280 that the facilities, some of the facilities that Michael ran, like the anti-gym and the ones that you ran together, Body by Michael and Kelly, were your father-in-law helped set those up.
He paid for everything.
He paid for everything.
Absolutely.
Were the facilities under your father-in-law's name?
Co-signer-wise, yes.
Co-signer-wise, okay. Mm-hmm. All right, so that's number one. Mm-hmm. He said that he had all of his facilities, all of his businesses, 3 years prior to meeting you. Is that true?
No, that is not true at all. He was a little bitty trainer in a loft complex, training probably about 30 people. And he and I married, and my dad... said, I'll help you if you want to grow your business. So my dad bought him a million-dollar building to start his business. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
And he said he started all but one business with you, all but one business he started prior to meeting you.
I don't know what businesses those would have been, because he didn't have any businesses before. He was just a trainer.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
You're going to find there's maybe... 95% of what he says is all a lie.
I have found that, and it's kind of interesting to verify this piece by piece.
Liar! Liar! Liar!
And as a special added asshole bonus, Kelly tells us about the way Michael screwed him over in other ways.
After my father gave him over $600,000, plus bought him a $1 million building.
Jeez.
Mm-hmm. And he walked out on all of that. My family is in major debt and is about to lose their ranch in Oklahoma because of him.
Oh,
geez. My credit is trashed.
Yeah.
He's dumped. There's $11,000 worth of equipment. They're coming after me because he did not pay the bill on a bunch of cardio equipment. So I'm right now in a lawsuit with that. They're going to try to garnish my wages. And the building in Cherry Creek... He walked out of that lease. That was over $500,000, and that fell back on my father. And then the building that my dad bought, he walked out on that mortgage because he was supposed to be paying the mortgage on it as my dad got him into the building. And that one is in foreclosure, and that one's $600,000. So he is over $1 million in debt with my family, what he has done.
Wow.
Yeah, he's a bad, bad guy. He is a bad – I mean, this is a narcissist to the max. The next step he hasn't done is just murder somebody.
Yeah.
I mean, he's someone you'd see on those crime shows. I'm serious.
And one interesting fact that came out of this that I wasn't anticipating was in reference to Michael getting evicted from his Curtis Street location. And a reporter found... tons of personal information, including credit card receipts, personal histories, all kinds of things in the garbage outside. And using Karolchyk's patented crazy logic, he, as the owner of that facility, was not actually responsible for the records afterwards.
When the IRS sees my gym, you get 1 hour to leave, Shannon. Mm-hmm. So maybe you wanted me to break in and break the law. I was removed. I had no access to any of that stuff or what have you.
Hey, I'll do tax evasion, but burglary? Fuck no. But Kelly actually shed some light on the fact that he only had an hour to leave as well.
When he knew he was going to get closed down because the IRS said, we're coming after you if you don't make these payments, because they interviewed my dad and I. And he still continued to run the business and take people's money and credit cards, but he knew at any day the IRS was coming to his door, and none of those people got their money back.
Liar! Liar! Liar!
And I hope someone's been counting at home, because I've completely lost track of how many lies that is for Michael Karolchyk in one 30-minute interview. So take what you will from that. Michael Karolchyk is a lying sack of crap. So there you go. And as one final part of this interview, I wanted to look at Pat Karolchyk claim that she never said that her son was a liar. And as we all can tell from this interview, he is a liar, so it wouldn't actually be all that inaccurate for his mom to describe him as such. However, in Pat's defense, she claims that, well, she puts it this way.
No, and like I said, the only time, and you can tell that to Michael, the only time, I never called him a liar. I just said that wasn't true, that his father wasn't a professor.
Okay.
And it's nothing to be ashamed of. He's head of the English department. And he was teacher of the year. Come on.
That, I mean, that is good. There's... One more thing. I talked to his mom, and she claimed that she never called him a liar. But she said that you had some audio of that. Is that true? Do you have audio of her saying that by chance?
No.
Okay. All right.
I don't know where she would have gotten that, but as a matter of fact, with our fact-checking process, we have an independent fact-checker, who isn't associated with my story. It's someone who works here at the magazine, but doesn't come in with any kind of axe to grind one way or another, and that fact-checker called her up and ran stuff by her, so, you know, if she would have had a problem with any kind of quote or anything that would have been attributed to her, or any kind of feeling or anything like that, definitely would have been run by her. Okay. So if she would have had any problems at that time, then it would have been flagged, and we would have gone back and rechecked it with her. I would have gone back with her and rechecked it, and there were no problems with it. I think actually, I think our fact checker came back and she said that I was a very nice person or something like that. So, yeah, so I imagine that it was obviously just deeply hurtful, the turn that Michael had taken in his life, and I think, you know, her husband definitely didn't know at first that she had talked to me, so he was more of the mind of just let him go and do what he wants to do, and, you know, he can, you know, when he comes back to us, then he can come back to us at that time, but they didn't. It didn't seem like her husband really wanted to even, you know, acknowledge him. But I felt really bad for his mother.
All right. So both sides had their say, and I had considered it dropped. But when I spoke with Kelly, she told me this without my prompting at all.
Yeah, his mother told me when things ended and she was on the phone crying with me, she said, "I am so afraid my son is a pathological liar." Huh. And it just broke her heart, and I said, "I think you're right, Patricia. Thank you." See.
And with that, the final nails in the coffin. At this point, I would urge, you know, any media outlets to reconsider using Michael as a source, because he's clearly demonstrated that he's unable to tell the truth. And to have somebody like that on television is dangerous, reckless, and irresponsible. So knock that shit off. And one final note, and then I swear this torture will be over. I have a message from Michael directly. Michael, first of all, we all know you hate fat people. That's great. You're really tough and you're really, you know, mean, and everybody hates you. Congratulations, you've succeeded in your goal. But here's the thing. Your mom hasn't talked to you in 3 years. give her a fucking call, man, okay? You can be the biggest dick you want to all the fat girls you want, but don't be a dick to your own mother, asshole. So why you gotta act like you know when you don't know?